Okay, let's dance. My name is Ricky. I'm from Hannover PM in Germany, and I work as self-employed programmer and system administrator. Most part of my work consists of e-commerce projects, and for these e-commerce projects, usually we write a web application which using databases. So a few years ago, I started using Dancer and DBX class for these web applications. So what is Dancer? What is DBX class? Dancer is a micro web framework, which makes it really easy to write your own web application. So Dancer is a micro web framework, which makes it really easy to write your own web application. Really so easy that even programmers from other languages like PHP and Ruby start with Perl just because of Dancer. So, and many web applications are using relational databases like MySQL and Postgres. DBX class is an object relational mapper which gives you objects instead of just data of your database records. This makes it more easy and convenient and even faster in most cases to read your database records and manipulating them. So I will start my presentation with short introduction to Dancer and DBX class, and then I will show you a general purpose application we wrote. It's called Table Editor. And after that, we are going into the gory details how to make work Dancer and DBX class together. So, Dancer is really too easy to start with. You get the application ready to go. I will show you in a minute. The syntax is easy to understand and it provides you with routes and keywords to help you to write your web application. So if you start a Dancer application, you can create one with the Dancer command. First of all, usually install Dancer and YAML for the configuration file. That's the first step. And the next step, you just say Dancer-A Dropbox. So you create an application named Dropbox. You change to the create a Dropbox directory, and then you run the command bin apl, and that starts the web application with its own web server, and you can go to localhost and port 3000, and you see the web application producing an HTML page. So this is the program, how it looks like when it's generated from the Dancer-A command. It's really simple, you see. You just use Dancer, and then use the main module of your Dancer application, so use Dropbox, and then dance, and then that's all to start. So in addition to this script, you're having a module, and you see it's a lib Dropbox PM. It has a package name Dropbox, and it loads Dancer. You put a version in it, and the next thing is this route. So it says whenever a request comes in, HTTP request, with GET, and matches this path, it executes this function, and it just gives you back an HTML page. So you looks up the template index and renders the HTML and pushes back to the browser. That's basically all. And the template itself consists of the layout, it's basically frame with menus and other stuff and footer and logo, whatever. And inside of the layout is of content which changes with every page. Like you have a page where you display your products, you have a page with a single product, you have a shopping cart. And you can even select different layouts, like the normal layout, you just say template index, which is a template file, and give some parameters, like name equals test. But you can also specify another layout called test, or even no layout, which is useful if you're producing HTML emails from a dense application. The route and keywords always, the routes always have a HTTP method. It might be get, post, or delete, put, and also any matches every HTTP method. And there's a path, like the part of the UI after the domain name, and a subroutine, which is called whenever this path matches. And you have several ways to define the path. It can be simple string, like I showed, slash index. It can have name parameters, wildcards, or even regular expressions. So another example for a route is this one. It matches slash home, and it basically shows a listing of all files in this Dropbox. And name parameters, you say slash home slash, and then you have the colon, which is the name parameter file, and you can get the value of the file. Maybe it's like image PNG or something, and you can find out what it is with the param keyword. So in this case, if you have a directory, it goes inside here, and then it shows the listing of the directory. The next thing is the wildcard. So it matches every JPEG image in this URI starts with images covers. And then you can get this part, which matches the asterisk with the splat keyword. And then you can check if there's really a file related to that in your file system, and then just send the image back to the browser. And if you don't have image, you can set the HTTP status with not found, which is a 404, and you're going to the standard 404 page of Denser. Then you have, can have a mega splat, which means you have two asterisks, so it matches all the part behind here. So this is the first one, the next one, it's basically unlimited. And then you get, also with the splat command, you get all parts of this path. So that is the email, and this is the hash. And you also can use any regular expression for the path of the route. So this is an example where you have a catch all route. So if you want to make something special, if you don't have this UI in another route, like if you have links for CEO, you look up this, the URL in the database and check if it's related to some content. You have to just make sure that this is the last route, otherwise it would overwrite all other routes. So you have a number of keywords you can use. So for example, this get post any, where you define the routes. You can look at the HTTP request and get the parameters out of it. And you can, for example, redirect your, send the redirect back to the browser. You can look at the configuration and that session. And you also have simple keywords to serialize and deserialize content. So this is great if you're writing a REST API where you produce the JSON to go back to the browser and you get the JSON from the other end. So for example, with the var keyword, you can simply store some data and retrieve it at another place, but this just is valid for one request. if you want to store data which can be used by multiple requests, you can, for example, write in it into the session. It's also easy to say, just username should be this email address, and then Quinn later can check for it, and if it's not there, you can redirect the user to the login page. And Dancer is really easy to expand. The Dancer core code is really lean and doesn't contain much more than the routes and the keywords, what I showed before. But for all the things you need for web application, there are plugins. For example, for database, email sending, or to connect to social networks. There are really lots of plugins you can go to cPAN and look at them. And there's other mechanism called hooks. I will show you how this works on the next slide. And then you have engines. Engines are exchangeable things you can use for templates, for logging, and for sessions. So you can pick, for example, your template engine instead of template toolkit, which is the major one. There are a lot of template engines in cPAN, and most of these have Dancer engines. And also can pick your login system if you want to log in the file or with syslog or whatever way. So this is an example for a hook. It is basically used for a password protected site. It's the before hook, which is called before before the request is dispatched to the routes. So you can check is the user logged in, or you check if it's the login page. But if the user is not authenticated, you just go say redirect to the login page, and then you go back to the cycle, and you have this exception, and it will show the login page. Dancer is also really solid. It's stable. We try to keep the current behavior. And there's a really great community around Dancer. If you need help, you can go to the IRC channel Dancer. You can write to the mailing list. And all this code is on GitHub too. And we're working actively on the issues which the people gave us. So. Next thing I'm talking about is DBX class. I said it's the object relational mapper. What does this mean? You're working with objects instead of handwriting your SQL. As I said, it's more convenient, and the team of DBX class went to great extents to make it really fast. And it's really likely that it's faster than your handwritten SQL. So how does this DBX class relate to a database? You have a schema, and the schema is basically the database. So if your database is, for example, named Interchange 6, you write a schema, for example, Interchange schema, and then in the database you have multiple tables, and the counterpart in the schema sind the result classes. So example, if you have a users table, you have a model called Interchange 6 schema result user, and your SQL queries you write by hand or get somewhere. This is these are result sets in the DBX class syntax. So for example, if you have a database which contains user and roles. You have some user identified by the username, which is an email address. And then you have different roles which each user can have. So for example, this one, Rackel@linux.id, he is a user, but he's also an admin. And these both ones might be an editor and an user. And all or not authenticated users, you can say they have a guest role. So in your relational database, you can set up three tables for that. So you have a users table with the user ID, email, first name, and other information. Then you have the roles table with the role ID and the name and label. And then you have a linked table which connects these both tables, because you need this because one user can have many roles, one or many. So, and if you want to find out which roles the user has, or the name of the role, you have to write a pretty complex SQL query with two joins. You see it's pretty long to get at this result. And you can easily mess up, of course, with the SQL query if you don't know the syntax very well. So it's much easier if you're using DBX class. So first you get a result set for user for this table. Then you look up the record with the user's ID 1. That's one way to get at this user object. Or are you just saying, I want to have the record where the email is equal racket.linux.de. So of course, this will have to be in unique in this table. Okay, so then you have your user object, and then you can look up all the fields with methods. For example, the first name field in the table, you can get with user first name. And if you find out the roles, that's another way you can search with like stuff. Okay. And to get to the roles, it's really simple. You get your user object, and then you call on the user objects the roles method. That's all. And all the SQL thing is behind the scenes. And how you write such a result class, you define the package and then say, my database table is users. Then I specify the columns and which is the primary key of the table. And then you can define the relationships to the other tables. Like we had the user role and the many-to-many relationship to the roles table. Okay, I skipped over that. Okay, so that was the introduction to DBX class. And with these two models, we wrote a general purpose application. It's called Table Editor. And the idea was that many people are using PHP MyAdmin and PHP PGAdmin to have an UI for working with a database, to insert records, to search for records, and all these things. But we figured that first it's in PHP, which we don't like so much. And also, you have for different databases, you have different software, and which kind of, don't know, it's not, we didn't like that. And we have this great DBI module, which abstracts a lot of things. So we were able, with Dance and DBX class, to write a table editor, which you can use to, in a similar fashion as to PHP MyAdmin, and also gives you more flexibility, as I will show you. So as I said, you can use it for different database system, like MySQL and Postgres, basically anything which is supported by DBX class. So, and it has a higher level of abstraction, because it's not focused on the database tables and columns, but on the schema which is produced by DBX class. And has a more front end, using responsive web design with Bootstrap and Angular to connect the front end with the REST API in the backend. And that means that the source code of the application on the backend is really concise and small, because all the display stuff, display work is done by Angular, which is basically JavaScript. And yeah, it has kind of simple installation. I will talk about this more later. So how it looks like if you don't have a schema configured for the table editor, it will come up with a form where you can put in stuff like the database driver and the database name and the credentials to connect to the database, and it will produce a schema for you. So you don't have to do any configuration for the table editor to connect to the database. And then you have a selection of all the tables on the left-hand side, and you can get the overview of some of one class. So for example, all the employees in the database. And you see we have paging here. You can select the number of records, and it will show the information. And here you have links to delete and edit. And then you go to the edit view and has the different fields, and has some nifty widgets to edit the stuff. And on top, you see also the relations to the other tables. So you can just go to this guy, to Georgie Farcello, and then click on titles, and you go to the page where you can view and add titles for this employee over time. Okay, so that was a quick overview of the table editor. I will show a little bit more later. So if you want to write application with Dancer and DBX class, how does it work? First of all, you use a plugin for Dancer, which is called Dancer Plugin DBIC. And I will explain how to use it, how to configure it, and give you a tip about UTF-8. And also, this plugin can create the database schema dynamically. So if you use DBX class in a normal application, you have your schema class, and then you can call connect. So you connect the schema to a real database, and then you can use all the functions, the result set, to search stuff in the schema in the database. That is how you're normally doing it, and the way which the Dancer plugin provides is not much different. You use the plugin in your Dancer application, and then you get the keywords, which are basically the same. So you have the schema, loads your schema, and then you have the result set, and you can search, or you can even go directly to the result set. This one is just a shortcut. So to let Dancer know which database are you using with your schema and which class you're using with your schema, you put the following configurations, plugins, DBSC, and this is the default one. So you have the DSN, which is the type of database and database name and user password, and your schema class. You can even use multiple schemas in your configuration. So, for example, we have an old database which we call with the tag legacy and the default one. So you can address the legacy one by passing the legacy to the schema keyword. Um, One thing you have to take care of in the days where most of us using databases with UTF-8 enabled is that that is not automatically recognized by the Dancer DBIC plugin. So you have to make sure that you put the following option in the configuration depending on the database. So for MySQL, it's MySQL underscore enable UTF-8. And that prevents data corruption. So if you put UTF-8 data in the database, like some Chinese characters or whatever, it will end up with the same characters in the database and not some byte trash. How does it create schemas dynamically? It does that if the schema class is not configured and it has to have a DBX class schema loader available. And then it just creates the schema from the by looking into the database, which columns we have, with which tables, and which foreign keys are present. I would say it's better if you are starting a real serious application with a database that you think about your how it's laid out and then write the schema more or less by hand. So you're sure that you have everything in place. But this thing can be a nice start to play around with it and learn a bit about DBX class. And of course, it's useful for the table editor. If you want to just edit some database where you don't have a schema for. I wrote a session engine for Dancer, which is used to store the session data into a database through DBIC. That can be used instead of storing the hashing in the file system. And it doesn't make sense because all your other data is already in the database. Why don't you put the sessions there already? And the difference in performance is not so big that you shouldn't do that. Okay. So as I said, you can use different engines for some cases. So you can do that for templates. Where you can select between different templating systems. And the same works for sessions, logger, and serializers. And the configuration, or you select your session engine in the configuration. So with session, you select the name, select the session engine with the name, in this case DBIC. With session options, you can give them additional configuration parameters like the database credentials and stuff like that. And also you can configure the expiration time of your sessions with session expires. Because you don't want usually keep the sessions around for forever. So you can configure that. And you can also do the configuration in your program instead of the configuration file. This is useful with DBIC because you already have the information to access the database in the configuration file for the plugin. So you can just say, in the session options, my schema is this schema I have with DBIC plugin. So, yeah. So, Dancer will automatically invalidate sessions which are older than the expiration time. But you have to take care to remove the old sessions. This is both true if you have file-based sessions, and it is true if you're storing sessions in the database. because all these sessions are not in use anymore, and they fill up your file system or your database. So you have to clean up this regularly with a cron job or something related to that. And in the examples, in the schema we are using, we put in the expire method where we print pass the time and then it will expire the sessions from the database. Okay, so now I'm going back to the table editor for a while. I will show you additional features, the installation, a few details about the front end. I will show an example route and what about the login. Okay, let's start with that. So additional features are widgets you can use for editing the records, which is a great thing. So at this time we have an HTML editor. So if you're storing HTML provided by users in your database, you can really edit with a VisiVig editor instead of doing the HTML manually. And then we have a date and time picker and widget for file uploads. So for example, we have if we add a new product, we have a SKU, which is an article number, a name and short description, and the long description you could put in HTML, which will be displayed on the product page. And you see if all the things you can use, so it eventually writes HTML into the database, but you can edit with these helpers. And usually you store also dates in the database. For example, for the employee, you have a hire date, and it's kind of complicated to edit this stuff manually. So we have a date and time picker. It works like a calendar. You can select the date and you can select the hour, minute, and then it goes to in this field. And another thing we have is file uploads. This is always a discussion whether you want to put the raw image into the database, or do you just store a reference to a file name and put the image itself in the file system. And we decide in most cases it's better to put it in the file system, and then you have to manage this in a database on your own. But for the table editor, you have a tool. So for the menu, for the navigation, you can go here and choose a file and upload it, and the table editor will store it in the directory you gave in the configuration. And yeah, you can use it in the web application. So installation, we don't have a real package right now, but the project is on GitHub, so we can just git clone it, go to the directory, fulfill the dependencies with cpanm, and then you can just run it. That's all. On top of the dependencies from cpan for the table editor, you need a database driver, so you have to install that as well. So dbd MySQL for MySQL databases and dbd pg for Postgres, and there are a lot more of these. Yeah. So the front end, I said, was done in responsive web with Bootstrap, which is a really cool thing because it allows you a lot of things to do which you otherwise doing manually, and you can easily change the theme of Bootstrap without just replacing a CSS file. And Angular is responsible for the data exchange and the display of all the data coming back from the REST API and showing in the forms and listings I showed before. So Angular is a JavaScript package, but if you look at the code you write with Angular, it doesn't look really like JavaScript. It looks like more like a programming language, a serious one. So this Angular has defined routes in the same fashion as Dancer has, so it knows which URL is related to a database record to show or related to a listing of records to show. And if the link is clicked in the front end, it will send a request to the REST API, which is wrote in Dancer, and asks for the data and gets the data back as JSON and then filling the HTML page with this information. So the routes inside of the Dancer REST API applications are fairly simple. Here we match the class, which is related to the database table and the primary key. And we prefix the method for the route with the require login, which checks if the user is logged in, which is another plugin which is really useful for Dancer. It's called Dancer plug in auth extensible. And then we just go to the DBX class schema and retrieve the database record and all the relationships. And this kind of data, we serialize with the two JSON keywords, so it's a basic JSON file which we send back to the front end, and Angular processes the data and displays it. So, yes, yeah, we're using a plugin for the authentication. It's really great. And if you do something in your web application, I can only recommend it. It has different providers. For example, you have a provider Unix, which looks up against your login user from your Unix. Or you have a provider for DBSC, which looks up this information in the database. One thing we don't have yet, which would be really useful, if you can log in with the same credentials as you have to use to access the database. This is not possible at the moment with this plugin. Okay. So the relationships which are available in DBX class are belongs to, as many might have as one and many to many. The first four can be detected by inspecting the result class. It's not so easy with many to many, because this just creates a method for the result class. But we recently figured out that we can look into the source code of the schema and find out which many to many relationships this class has. And the configuration for the table editor extends to configuring the out extensible plugin and also the parameters for the DBX class. So I saw here the extra widget provided by table editor. How can you relate this to your database records? Some of them are detected because if you have like the date columns, table editor knows about it and then uses this date time picker widget. But not always this information is available from the schema. So you can also configure it in the Dancer configuration file for the table editor application. So we say, let's say we have a media class where we store images with the file name reference. And we say this is in the UI column of the table. And then we can pick the column type. which relates to the widget which is which the front end is using, and the upload directory, how large the files can be which are uploaded, because you don't want to load too big files to push to the application, and also which extensions are valid. Yes. So this was so far the overview about the table editor. You can join the development at GitHub. And yeah. All this table editor was written on top of Dancer 1. We were working on a Dancer 2, which changed a lot of things and will eventually replace Dancer 1. So if you want to know more about Dancer 2, there are Sawyer, I guess he will give him talk about that. Is that true? Do you have a talk about Dancer 2? You should do it. Okay, no problem. So if you want to have a web application with Dancer 2 and DBX class, you can do that because the DBX plugin and the session engine are already ported to Dancer 2. But the table editor application is not available for Dancer 2 right now. So I'm almost at the end of my talk. You can go to the ACT system and download my slides for this presentation. And I also have a short announcement before we go to the possible questions. So we're doing a Perl Dancer conference this year in October in New York. Not directly in New York City, but in the state of New York. And this conference is about Dancer and DBX class. And we have two famous guest speakers. This is Sawyer from the Dancer project and Riba Sushi, the mastermind behind DBX class. So do you have any questions to my presentation? Okay. In this case, if no one has a question, thank you for listening.